So it's not gold, it's not silver, but it is amazing piece of history, and it's really totally precious because I've got it in my hand here. I'm touching an ancestor of the deepest kind, and you know, that touches me. Oh, it does. Oh, yeah. So this is the field where Nugget found that Dupondus of Augustus from Nimes with a crocodile on. So I thought I'd go back over it because, you know, we really only just scraped it around here. Might be more. So I'm back. First find of the day is a musket ball. In the pocket with that one, it's fired. So this looks exactly like a spindle wool, but it isn't. And it's not Celtic ring money either. I think it's off a clock. Have a look. So you see that, you go, oh, spindle wool, but no, not like that. You see it's got those teeth. So it's like a double train. I don't know. But it doesn't look that old. I mean, you know, maybe 1800s, late 1800s, but don't know what that is. If you know, post below. If you have an idea, post down here. If you know what it is, do the biz. Well, you wonder what that is. And then you think, well, maybe it's off up there, off that lamppost, that power line. Some sort of blob of solder. That's what I think that is. But if you know, post below. Well, it was a really good signal, and it turned out a nice thing, but it wasn't what I wanted. So I was disappointed at first, but then I thought, actually, it's really nice. You're gonna like this much. It's a bicycle license. That's when bicycles were dangerous. Oh yes. And you had to get a license for them. Like the people that ride through red lights and up the one-way street the wrong ways don't. You know, anyway, 1926, bicycle license. Not finding much, just found another musket ball. Have a look. There you go, it's been shot, hit something, the ground maybe. And that's a pistol ball. Well, this is You Can't Always Get What You Want part two. You can always get what you want, but you get what you need. Now, I think I know what this is. Have a look, and I'll tell you what it is when you've had a look at it. Anyway, here goes. Now, I bet you anything you like, well, actually not anything you like, but I bet you, that is a Neolithic flint core, which some caveman, might not even been a human, might have been a Neanderthal or any one of a number of Homo erastuses and all that sort of thing, used as his raw material for his stone tools. And so he got a nice bit of flint and then he whittled it down to a block called core. And then he split bits off. He flaked them off to get his tools. And I bet if I bang this with my spade, it will go ding! Because that's what they would look for. They look for stones that sang, which meant they were solid. I might even do that in a minute. But that, I believe, is a Neolithic stone core for making tools from. And that's really, really exciting. I mean, you know, buttons from 1700 is one thing. You know, Roman coins is another. But this goes back not only before history, but before humanity even. When our forebears were making tools from stones, and which is really kind of what separated hominids from the other animals and certainly set us on our way to where we are now. So it's not gold, it's not silver, but it is an amazing piece of history, and it's really totally precious because I've got it in my hand here. I'm touching an ancestor of the deepest kind, and you know, that touches me. Oh, it does. Oh yeah. This is my prehistoric face. Anyway, there you go, stone core. Well, it's a funny old field, this. Got a poor signal, but you know, gotta dig it all, you gotta dig it all. Poorly signal, not much of a signal. Anyway, I got a coin down here, and it looks like a big bronze one, so it should have been given a stronger signal, and it didn't. So you see that there? That is our coin. So I'm guessing that's going to be a Napoleon toile, but it looks slightly too irregular, but it might be, you never know, do you know? So there it is. And is that our man Napoleon toile? No, I don't know, do you know? I mean, it's highly likely to be, but I don't recognise the features at this moment. What's that on that side? Oh yeah, there you go. There's the eagle. So on the other side must be Napoleon toile, and that's a five son teams.
A coin at last! Well, you don't often get this particular coin, which I just found, in good condition. It's what I call a fishy fishy, which is the wartime collaborator coins of the French fascists. I mean, people don't normally like to put it like that, but French had fascists, everybody had fascists at the time, just some had more fascists than others. So anyway, when the Germans came in, they took over and they appointed a French pseudo-government, fake government, the Vichy government, and they made their own coinage, like this one here, which is a 1 franc. Take a look.
So you see, 1942, I think that says, and normally, because this is an aluminum coin, these are completely eroded to bits. And you see, that's the fascist double-headed axe. And, you know, all the symbols of, you know, fatherland and all that malarkey. So, no, yeah. And normally, it doesn't come out this nice. Does it say 10 francs? I think, no, it doesn't say 10 francs. It looks like it does. But on that side, there's a 1, so it's a 1 franc. See, my eyes becoming weak. Anyway, a fishy vishy in good nick.
Well, I haven't found a piece by Mozart. I found a
bit of Handel. That's rather nice. That goes back to the wife. She loves this stuff.
I was so sure I'd found a Roman. I mean, have a look at this.
Came out like that. And I thought, oh, it's a Roman. Oh, I'm not going to switch all the camera on and reveal it together because I know it's not going to be one. And it wasn't. But it's a nice thing. I don't know what it is. It's some kind of Bertone. See, it's lovely, lovely condition. Nice patina, so it's not new. But it ain't no Roman coin. Anyway, in the pocket goes. It's quite nice, really.
It was weird. I just knew it wasn't a Roman, even though every single sinew in my body was saying, it's a Roman, it's a Roman. And it wasn't. I'm obviously fantasising about Romans, because it's the second piece that just so looked like a Roman. I thought, it's a Roman. No, it's not going to be. I know it's not going to be. And it wasn't. Have a look.
So it came out the ground, well, maybe not at that angle, that sort of angle, and you know, that's sort of Roman coinish, but that isn't. So whether that's a musket ball that's hit something, I don't know. It could actually be a coin, a really old coin, a Celtic coin, which they struck like that sometimes. Very rarely, but they did. More likely to be a bullet. But we'll clean it carefully and see if there's anything there, because if it's a coin, it'll have some design. But I'm saying that that's a shot musket ball. Look at that, you see. That's what you expect from a Roman coin when it comes out the ground. Maybe not quite that thick, but in that sort of zone.
Well, I mean, sort of a semi-hot spot, but nothing major, but bits and bobs, like this musket ball. Have a look.
So there you go. Unfired pistol ball, maybe? I would say musket ball. You see those big old ones, but I mean, I don't think they went shooting small creatures with those. They just, you know, make a mess of them. So I still think that's a musket ball, but it could be a pistol ball. Anyway, it's unfired. Now, the other thing around here is quite interesting.
All around me are inedible mushrooms, hundreds of them, and they're called dapplings. They're down here. I'll show you one. Let me get you a good one. See, that's a dappling. There's another dappling. There's another one. There's two more over there. They're literally everywhere. There's one there. And you can't eat them. I don't think they're poisonous. They're just not going to do you any good. And the whole field's full of them. This is my excited face, my excited face. Oh, the time works charm. I think I've got Roman. It's only a fragment, but have a look. I think that's a Roman, or it could be something, you know, Celtic or something like that, but I think it's a Roman. Have a look.
So there it is. It's a bit of bronze. And it's a fragment of a coin for sure. Well, not for sure, but sure enough. And that, I think, has to be a bit of a Roman coin. So, going to concentrate around here. Very deep it was too.
Well, there's a little bit going on here. Here's a little double turnwire that just popped up. Very nice too.
So they've got decent patinas, these coins. Don't know whether they've got any decent detail on it or not. Looks like it might have some. See, that's too round for a Roman. Too regular. But I'm guessing that that is a double turnoir.
Well, I just got a big boy signal. I mean, you know, sort of a big copper coiny signal. Silver signal is that high. So, you know, Coke can, that kind of thing. And I've just dug it up and pushed it over, and I just saw a glimpse of a coin, just a glimpse, and it's buried again. I think it's a copper coin, but I don't know. So we're going to find out together. Got the old pinpointer. Let's go up a pinpointing. That's here somewhere. That's where I think I saw it. No, it isn't there. Oh, there it is. Oh, it's tiny. I thought it was going to be huge. So that's a denier or a double turnoir. Didn't rip the coin. Oh, look at that, that's in good condition. What is that? Now that definitely looks unusual. It might even have a date on it. Let's have a look at the other side. There's going to be a king's head there, and it's going to be in good condition because it looks like it's stood up well to the soil. Oh, that's lovely, that is. There you go. And that is a denier of 16 something or other. Does it say 1671? I don't know, I don't know. But anyway, beautiful one. That's a beauty. That really is a beauty. All the times I dig up those coins and they're absolutely blasted. And this one's in really good condition. So it's like a 1 in 50. Oh, yes, thank you very much. So another little denier right down here in this, I wouldn't say it's a hot patch, but it's a warm patch. Just a normal little denier. I'll show it to you now.
So there you are. I want to stop saying, have a look. Could you get bored of that? So that's the standard little denier. Probably some details on it, but not much.
Well, if this was brass or bronze, I'd be overjoyed. But it's iron, but I should really love it just as much. Have a look.
It's a lovely iron buckle from who knows when. Well, pre-Second World War at the very least. Well, I'll take it with me. In the bag it goes. You see, that very, very, very easily could be a Neolithic awl. And I know I've got some experts out there. So you can tell me, am I right? It's going in the pocket. But of course you can, you know, start seeing things if you start looking too hard. But, you know, that core is definitely a core. And about, I don't know, 100 metres from here, I found that beautiful, beautiful Neolithic hand axe, probably Neanderthal or maybe even before that. And that just looks way too like it should be an awl of some kind. In the pocket it goes.
Do I have to tell you I'm right by the car? Do I? I thought, well, I've been out here for 2 or 3 hours. I don't want to exhaust myself and then, you know, have to take 2 or 3 days off while all my bits and pieces, you know, go back to normal. I'd go a little bit early, so I'm right by the car. It's literally, I could throw the coin in my hand and hit my car. I won't show you it. It's covered in bird poo. But anyway, it's in my hand. Have a look.
So it's a slick one. Doesn't, I mean, should be a Napoleon Toire. It doesn't feel like a Napoleon Toire. It feels like a Liard, one of the late Liards, or half a sole or whatever it was. I don't know, but it's not perfectly round. So I think it's pre-revolutionary. So it's going to be Louis the 14th or Louis the 15th, Louis the 16th, or Louis the 17th or Louis the 18th or Louis the... No, there were those Louis, but they weren't really king. Anyway, we'll find out later after I give it a good going over.
Well, these days, I'm hunting for 3 sorts of treasure. Metal treasure with my metal detector. Mushroom treasure with my eyes and my basket. And stone treasure, Neolithic and Paleolithic stone flint tools. It's been a bumper year for mushrooms and they're growing all over the back garden. So I'm gonna go harvest some right now. Well, I'm told by my wife they're here. Oh, I see them. Okay, so these are mature, and I must say I prefer them mature because A, they taste better, and B, you can't mistake them for button mushrooms or poisonous ones. So let's cut them. So this is a mushroom brush for brushing the leaves off them, if you want to do that. And here we've got the blade for cutting the mushrooms. And that's a special mushroom cutting blade. And these will probably only be 2 or 3 days old. Well, don't need that knife. So there we are, mushroom colour, no bulb. None of that nasty amanita stuff going on there. Now, button mushrooms are nowhere near as tasty as these mature ones. Nowhere near. And now it's pouring outside. And I want to show you our parasol mushrooms. And here is some of what's been a huge crop of parasol mushrooms. And they've been growing in a straight line from over there through here. And down there and into the bushes. You see, there's a whole huge amount in the bushes there. And all the brambles have kept them safe. So anyway, let's get these chaps. And there's a little one coming up. I'll leave that one. Oh, okay, I'll leave it in my way. So it looks like they're coming to the end, because that's a baby. It doesn't look like it's going to get as big as, say, that one there. It's incredibly warm for autumn. Oh, and it's Smokey, the mushroom hunting cat. This is why they picked them small, because the things come and eat them. And of course, you couldn't sell that in a store, could you? No, you couldn't. Well, I'd buy it. And look at all those in there. We've got enough. So maybe we might come back tomorrow and clear away the brambles to get at them. But it's basically in a straight line. Was it a road? Is it a huge ring? It just looks straight, but in fact it's a ring. Or is it just a weird mushroom fact? So the parasols
Well, they look like a parasol. And this looks like a cat. It looks like Smokey, the treasure hunting cat. And it's that top and the length of the stem that gives it away. Now, this is a parasol mushroom with a very fat stem. But some of them are very, very fine stems indeed. And it's that kind of flaky pattern. It's not dots, it's like concentric flakes that gives it away. Smokey, go in there and get me all those mushrooms. Yes, go on, go in there, go on. So here's a little one. It doesn't have that scary bulb of an amanita. And it comes out with a white or brownish cap, and then it splits up like this one here, and then it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and gets the flat top. And as you can see, they grow in families. And that's quite a little family. And we must have had 100 parasols this year. And they're growing all over the place, just not in our garden. So this is quite a good way to identify them. They have this sort of like a washer underneath them. They have the thin stem. And they have that sort of scaliness. Definitely coming to the end of this run, I think. So let me pick one of these more fresher ones, if I can get in between the brambles. Ow, ow! Didn't hurt much. So there you go. There's that washer, which was under it when it was a button. There's the scaly pattern, concentric around the top. The white gills, which don't tell you much, really. I'm sure if you took a pattern, it would help you identify it, if you needed to, if you're at that level of sophistication. But there's the stem, there's the way the stem behaves. And that's a delicious parasol mushroom. And there's a nice collection. And there's some for tomorrow. And this is Rusty Poos, who's another rescue of ours. She was rescued this year, came to us completely starved. Didn't you, Rusty? Didn't you? But now, she's been eating solidly for 6 months. You have, haven't you? Solidly eating. Anything put in front of you. And now she's got her size and strength back. She's an old cat. 14 years old, that sort of thing. Anyway, she's found a little haven. Nice collection. Our own personal harvest festival. And there's Newton hunting Rusty. So how about that for the fruits of country living? I'm never going to get slim. Not bad, huh? And I like marrow. Very much indeed.